Welcome back, all of you. In the last two classes, or even three classes, I would say, we discussed a lot about multidimensional NMR, focusing mainly on two-dimensional techniques, and explained to you the time dependence, choosing the dimensionality, what is the advantage of different two-dimensional experiment, what type of experiment you have to choose, and what is the polarization transfer mechanism for some of the pulse sequence like INEPT, TOXI, ROSI, etc. A number of pulse sequences which are commonly used, both homonuclear and heteronuclear, were discussed. And I took the special example of a COSI, which is a simple two pulse sequence, where I discussed and explained how the magnetization between two coupled spins, especially when I took the example of A and X, how it gets transferred from A to X or X to A. I said in the evolution period T1, the precision frequency of spin A, when it remains same in detection period also, it gives us a cross peak. It gives us a diagonal peak, which frequency remains same, nu A and nu A both in T1 and T2 dimensions. However, it gives it magnetization to the coupled spin also. As a consequence, then in the frequency domain spectrum, you are going to get a peak which is different. In addition to diagonal, you may also get a peak in the frequency domain spectrum, that is a cross peak. This is what we discussed, and I took an example and showed how we get the cross peaks and how we get diagonal peaks. So please remember, diagonal peaks in the COSI come when there is no coupling. As a consequence, if there are n protons, let us say, none of them are coupled among themselves, in which case you get only peaks on the diagonal and nothing else. And what do you get in the one-dimensional spectrum? Exactly same. As a consequence, the diagonal spectrum of the COSI corresponds to one-dimensional spectrum. Simple. Please remember, the diagonal peaks in the COSI spectrum corresponds to simple one-dimensional spectrum. Now, let us take some example of a 2D COSI spectrum of uncoupled spins, two uncoupled spins I am taking. Let us say one is precessing at frequency nu A, other is precessing at the frequency nu X. Now, when we take the COSI spectrum of this molecule, we are going to get spectrum like this. Remember, I said these two spins are uncoupled. As a consequence, this nu A has the same positional frequency both in T1 dimension and in T2 dimension. Similarly, the spin nu X has the same frequency both in T1 and T2 dimensions. So then what is the type of peak you are going to get? You see, you are going to get peaks only on the diagonals. And because there is no J coupling, remember, as I said in the last class, J coupling is one of the requisite for the COSI. Only then the polarization transfer takes place between two coupled spins. That is the mechanism of transfer through J coupling. Now J coupling is not there. So this continues to process and it will not transfer its magnetization to nu X in the T1 period. Similarly, nu X will not transfer magnetization to nu A. So there is no cross peak at all. What we are seeing is only diagonal peaks. So this is the 2D plot, 2D spectrum in the contour part. Okay, contour. Now we can do one more thing. We can get the spectra. This is the diagonal, contains only the chemical shift information. Now I can plot the projection of the spectrum. This is the F2 projection. The spectrum, if I take the projection and plot on the top of it, this peak comes like here, this peak comes here. This looks like a one-dimensional plot. Of course, it's not one-dimensional spectrum. Plot looks like one dimension, not correspond to this diagram, one-dimensional spectrum, and it is a projection. Of course, if there are peaks here, that will also come. Okay. Now, you can see, take the same projection along this side also. I'm sorry, this should be F1 projection. There's a typo. It has to be F1 projection. The projection along this axis is F2 projection. This is the way normally 2D cosine spectrum is plotted. You get the spectrum plotted in both the dimensions, both the frequency dimensions, and you can start looking at the peaks. These are the diagonal peaks. If there is a coupling, if the spin gives its magnetization to a coupled spin, you get cross peaks which are symmetric with respect to the diagonal on either side. Because remember why it is symmetric. Nu A gives peak to nu X. Nu X also simultaneously gives peak to nu X. So it, with respect to the diagonal, because chemical shift range is both same in both the dimensions, the cross peaks in the cosine is always symmetric. Okay, this is the spectrum corresponding to two uncoupled spins. Okay, now let us consider the example of what type of information cosine gives. The presence of scalar coupling interaction between the spins is the basic requirement, I said. If I take a molecule like this and start looking at the 2D cosine spectrum, what I am going to get? This is coupled to this through J coupling, and this chemical shift of this comes at the diagonal, chemical shift of this comes at the diagonal, and because there is a J coupling, and these two also give rise to cross peaks. Similarly, this and this gives rise to cross peak, and this gives rise to cross peak. It can go like this, it can go on and on like this. So what I am trying to say is, so long as there is a coupling, you get cross peaks to all the coupled spins. Of course, depending upon the mixing time and the strength of coupling, you may also get long range coupling in cosine. You can see this is coupled to this also. You may see this coupling, this cross peak also. It doesn't give energy. See this, let us say this proton in the T1 period, it is positioning at certain frequency and gives part of its magnetization to this. It can also give part of the magnetization to this because it is coupled if there is a long range coupling. It is not restricted only to immediate neighbors. Of course, probability of gear, this is immediate neighbors because that coupling strength is larger. But does not mean it cannot give its magnetization to the protons which it is coupled to, which is 2 or 3 bonds away. It can also give rise to long range coupling and a cross peak to that one. So this is the thing. So although I have written 2D cosine conventionally identifies immediate coupled neighbors, please remember you can also get cross peaks to the long range coupled protons. Please remember this point. Okay. Now I'll take the cosine pattern of two spins which are weakly coupled. Coupled, in the previous example I took uncoupled. Now what is the pattern you are going to get if the two spins are coupled? And if the two spins are coupled, already we discussed, and especially weakly coupled case, it must be treated like two AX spins. So you will get doublet for A and doublet for X. This we have already analyzed n number of times, so I don't have to repeat it. So let us say this is the AX spectrum. I am going to plot the projection. The projection is nothing but what you see on the diagonal here. This is the F2 projection. This is the F1 projection. And I call this as chemical shift of A. This is chemical shift of X. Same spectrum I am getting in this dimension also. Because I am correlating only chemical shifts, identical spectra I am getting in both the dimensions. Okay. This is the diagonal. Now, in the cosine spectrum, what are the peaks we are going to get? First, identify the dimensions. This is F1 and F2, T1 and T2, omega R, omega 1, omega 2, whatever you want, you can identify. Now, first, I am going to get identify peaks on the diagonal. See, I am going to identify 1, 2, 3 and 4. 4 peaks are on the diagonal corresponding to chemical shifts or frequencies of 2 doublets for all the 4 peaks. There are certain peaks here and here. We will see that. We will come to that later. And what does it mean? The delta A is processing in both T1 and T2 dimension with the same frequency. So, it gives rise to the peak at its own frequency. That is diagonal peak. So, this is nothing but nu A comma nu A. In the F1 dimensions also, F1 dimension is this frequency is nu A. If you come in the F2 dimension also, this frequency is nu A. So, it appears at its own frequency. This is a diagonal peak. Now, similarly, X also appears at its own frequency because the frequency of X, the precisional frequency, remains same both in T1 and T2 dimensions. Fine. Now, if you look at this, there are cross peaks between them. These two are doublets, and we know this is coupled to this, and there is a polarization transfer between this pin and this pin. Okay. When it happens, when this pin gives the part of its magnetization to this in the T1 dimension during the evolution time, or this gives to this because of coupling, I said we get cross peaks. True. But why there are extra peaks here in addition to diagonal? These are also cross peaks. These are in both A and X, we get what is called autocorrelated peaks. They correlate within themselves. A spin, the doublet pattern correlates within itself. It is not the correlation to another spin. The doublet pattern, two P frequencies, will correlate within itself. That is called autocorrelated peaks. So you can see these autocorrelated peaks both for A and both for X. Both are autocorrelated peaks. Is it clear for you now? But remember, this does not tell me about which spin is coupled to which. This is simply within the multiplate, there is a correlation. That's all. Doesn't give me any additional information. Simply remember, this is an autocorrelated, these are autocorrelated peaks. A correlate within itself, X correlate within itself, gives a frequency within itself. Okay. This is what I said. A appears at its own frequency, X appears at its own frequency, both give autocorrelated peaks. Now, the frequency of A is modulated at the frequency of its coupled partner X. I told you, A gets modulated because of X, because it gives part of its polarization to X during evolution. Similarly, X gives part of its polarization to A. The frequency of A gets modulated at the frequency of its coupled partner. So, what will happen? A is going to give cross peaks. So, now at the frequency of A in the F1 dimension and at the frequency of X in the F2 dimension. Please understand, this is the frequency of X in the F2 dimension. This is the frequency of A in the F1 dimension. So, because it gets modulated due to the frequency of coupled partner, A will give rise to frequency at X, at its coupled partner. Now, what happens to X? X also gets modulated because interaction is mutual in NMR. So, X also gets modulated at the frequency of A and gives rise to cross peak at its coupled partner A. Now, you understand, A not only gives frequency at its own frequency, it gives us to autocorrelated peaks because of this splitting pattern. Frequency of A gets modulated with the frequency of A because it's a coupled partner and gives us to frequency cross peaks or peaks at X. Similarly, X appears at its own frequency. Not only that, it gives us to autocorrelated peaks for its splitting, for its doublets. In addition to that, X gets modulated because of A. These two interactions are mutual and gives us the cross peak at A. That's what it is. So, when the frequency of A gets modulated with X, you got here. X frequency gets modulated, you got cross peak here. Simple logic. If there are three protons are coupled among themselves, then if at the frequency of A, M and X get modulated. Let us say I have three spin protons, A, M and X. At frequency of A, M and X also get modulated. So, you get cross peaks at M and cross peak at X. If you look at M, M gets modulated at due to the frequency of A and X. So, it gives cross peaks at M, A and cross peak at M. Similarly, X has a coupled partner A and M, and it modulates the frequency at A and M, gives us the cross peak at them. So, this is simple logic. Whenever the coupled spins have their frequency modulated at the respective coupled partner, there you are going to see the cross peaks. Please understand. So, whenever this coupled spin gets modulated its frequency with its coupled partner, at that frequency you get a cross peak. So, this is what happens. So, you got cross peak. So, these are called cross peaks. Okay. Now, always remember, in homonuclear 2D COSY, the cross peaks must appear as pairs. Symmetric with respect to diagonal, cross peak always appears as pairs. Remember, you saw it behind. This and this always appear as pair. If A gives cross peak to X, X also has to give cross peak at A. And it is symmetric with respect to diagonal, you see. It has to be perfectly symmetric. This is one of the pattern for COSY. Please remember that. It has to be symmetric with respect to diagonal. So, now with this, what we will do is, let us see. I have a mixture of two AX spin systems. I have chosen this molecule deliberately. This and this gives rise to coupling. It forms a coupled spin system. I assume chemical shift between these two protons are sufficiently large compared to scalar coupling. So, I consider this as weakly coupled spin system AX. I chose another molecule. Similarly, I will say these two protons also form weakly coupled AX spin system. Now, I take the mixture of both the molecules and want to do the COSY. How does the 1D NMR spectrum look? First of all, this looks like this. Why? Each AX spin system gives us to four lines. Two lines at A and two lines at X. This we have been discussing for quite some time. So, there are two such AX spin systems. So, we should get eight lines. And what are these? One is the chemical shift of 1, 2 and 3 and 4. All the four protons are there. I have four chemical shifts. And each of them is a doublet because each one is coupled to its coupled partner. So, because of that, there are two sets of two doublets. Now, the question for me is, what are the coupled partners? I don't know. I have just taken the 1D spectrum. This is what I get. Now, I want to know in this spin system, where I want to identify which are these two doublets and which are these two doublets. Now, if I am asked a question, whether this and this form a pair of doublets, whether these two form pair of a doublet, whether this and this form pair of doublet, or this and this form pair of doublet, I do not know. There are several possibilities here. I am getting a conventional spectrum. Now, I want to identify the coupled partner. Let us say two reds are coupled partners and two blues are coupled partners. Then I know this is chemical shift of A and these are all chemical shifts of A and X. Fine. What about now coupled partners are 1, 2 and 3, 4. What about 1, 3 and 3, 4? You do not know. These two could be coupled partners. 1, 3 and 2, 4. Also, these two could be coupled partners. 1, 4 and 2, 3. So, various possibilities are there. Now, if you are asked to find out which are the coupled partners, what you will do? Simply run a Cauchy experiment. Now, what is the type of pattern I am going to do for a Cauchy experiment? Tells me which are the coupled partners. Please understand. Simply do a 90 T190 Cauchy experiment. That's all I will do. Two-dimensional Cauchy. Now, my first condition is possibly 1 and 2 are coupled partners. I don't know. Or 3 and 4 coupled partners. If this is the situation, what type of spectrum, Cauchy spectrum I get? Look at this. These are all diagonal peaks and orthocorrelated peaks. Now, if these two are the coupled partners, 1, 2, now I will get cross peaks at 1, 2. And if they act similarly, 3 and 4 coupled partners, I will get. See, what another interesting thing you should know is they are symmetric with respect to diagonal. To identify the cross peak, all what you have to do is sit at the center of this peak, doublet. Come vertically down. Come to the center of this doublet. Go horizontally. You meet the diagonal. Again, go vertically up. Complete the square. You form a beautiful square because cross peaks in the Cauchy are symmetric with respect to diagonal. Then I know diagonal peak, if you see this and this, these two are the two protons which are coupled between them. So the cross peaks tells me there is a cross peak between this and this, here and here. That means this proton and this proton are coupled. There is a J coupling between these two. So this is one of the AX coupled spin system. This is one of the coupled partners. Clear? Now, let us look at other one. So, I completed the square. Started from the center, come down, went and completed the square. This undoubtedly tells me delta 1 and delta 2 are coupled. Go to the next one. You should get the pattern similarly for 3 and 4. Because this is the chemical sheet of 3 and this is the chemical sheet of 3. Look at the spectrum, come down, go horizontally, go up, complete the square. So this diagonal peak and this diagonal peak are there, this proton and this proton are coupled. And that's why we are getting the cross peaks for these two. So delta 3 gives diagonal peak and also cross peak with its coupled part 4 here. Similarly, 4 gives a diagonal peak and also gives cross peak with its partner here, delta 3. So they are symmetric. Perfect. Now I know what are the coupled partners. This was assuming these two are coupled partners. This should be the type of Cauchy spectrum you get. Now what happened to the second possibilities I thought? I thought this could be coupled partners, two red and blue. Two blues are there. Maybe these two red doublets are coupled. These two blue doublets are coupled. They are coupled spins. We don't know. Now, if that is the situation, how my 2D Cauchy spectrum comes? Again, write down the diagonal peaks. Now, because these two are coupled partners, the cross peak appears between 1 and 3. Perfect, you see? From the center of this delta 1, come vertically down, go horizontally up and complete the square. That shows delta 1 and delta 3, which are diagonal peaks, they are coupled. As a consequence, they give cross peaks between them. Clear? So, if these two are coupled, delta 1 and delta 3, this is the cross peak pattern you should get in Cauchy. And if delta 2 and delta 4 are coupled, again, you get the cross peaks like this, between 2 and 4. Now, this is the pattern. Look at the pattern for this Cauchy spectrum when these two are coupled and the Cauchy pattern we saw when these two are coupled. Entirely different, but it gives you fantastic information about coupled patterns. You can find out which is coupled to which. Fine. Now, what is my last possibility I thought of? I thought of one possibility. 1 and 4 are coupled and 2 and 3 are coupled. Now tell me, how do we get the crossfit pattern? Again, write down the diagonal peaks. Now I am assuming 1 and 4 are coupled. 1 should give rise to cross peak to 4. Should be here. Similarly, 4 should give rise to cross peak to 1. It is here. So now start from here. Come down. Go horizontally. Go up and complete the square. Now you identified these two coupled partners. Similarly, now go to 2 and 3. 2 and 3 give rise to coupled partners like this. 2 gives cross peak here, 3 gives cross peak to 2, and you can complete the square. See the patterns, depending upon which pattern is coupled, there are 3 possibilities, and we saw 3 types of coupling patterns. Cross peak patterns are different in the course. So then you can identify easily coupled patterns. This is a hypothetical example. I took 2 coupled spring system, I wrote a stick plot here to make you understand. But in reality, you can understand yourself. And let us try to now start with a simple example, a realistic example of a Cauchy spectrum like this. The 1D spectrum of this molecule is given as a projection here. Now, this is a symmetric proton. I know it always comes at high field. Of course, it's a simple spectrum I can interpret. Assuming I don't know anything about analysis, I simply ran a Cauchy. Now start with one peak. At least something we will have to start. We'll start with this peak. I know this peak is coupled to this because you start from the diagonal, come vertically down, go horizontally and complete the square. That shows that this peak, diagonal peak, this diagonal peak corresponds to these two protons are coupled. I identify the coupled partner. That must be this CA3 and this CH2. Fine, because it's a triplet and a quartet. But you can see from your molecule, this CH2 can also experience coupling to this. That's why you have a pentate pattern. We know that, you know. Pentate or sextate pattern we are seeing. So we'll continue further. We identified 2 protons. Now, from the CH2, which you identified, continue further and you can form another square. Come here, hit a cross peak, go horizontally and complete the square. You see another peak. So that means this proton and this proton are also coupled. And this proton corresponds to this CH2. That means this CH2 is coupled to this and also this. Very easy to assign. You understood now how to assign the Cauchy spectrum. And OH, there was no cross peak because OH is not coupled to. So I am not seeing any cross peak to OH, so it doesn't come. In principle, it should have been, there should have been a diagonal peak. It is missing. It's okay. So now let us look at this molecule, 2-chlorobutane. I know the formula, I know the spectrum. Of course, again, you start the interpretation. Start with the one of the peak which you know. I think this must be CH3. We all agree, right? High field it is coming, is a triplet because of the CH2. Let us start with the assumption. Start with that peak. Oh, we can start with this CH3 because it's a doublet because of this. That's also fine. If we don't have to start with this, we can start with this also. So with that CH3, now come horizontally, vertically down, go horizontally, then you will hit upon. You will complete the square, you hit upon this proton. Then this must be CH because the CH3 was a doublet. CH3 was a doublet because it is coupled to CH. And this CH is a quartet because it is coupled to CH3. You identified that. Now what is next? You can also see that this CH, if you carefully see, has 2 cross peaks, one here. Okay, in addition to that, it has another cross peak. You trace this completely and you will see it is going to hit upon this diagonal peak. This is CH2. So this CH2 or this CH proton is coupled to this CH2. It gives us a cross peak. Now this CH2 again complete the square. This CH2 is coupled to this CH3. You see, you can complete the square. From this, go horizontally, vertically, you complete the square. So, very easy. Systematically, stepwise manner, you can go. Started with the CH3, which I knew. I completed this one. I hit upon CH. I know that. And I also came to know this CH is coupled to CH2. From CH2, I can find out it is also coupled to CH3. So, entire coupling network I could assign by one spectrum. That is the beauty of coasing. See, let us quickly go to another molecule, ethyl 2 butyonate. Now, there are five groups of chemical inequivalent protons. 1 and 2 here, 1, 2, 3 here, identified as A group and B group. Fine. Now, let us look at one of the peaks which you think is easily assignable. Let us look at this B. I just see a 3 proton here. It was named numbered 5. If you carefully see, it is a triplet. It is not expanded. If you see, it is a triplet. No doubt about it. We will start with the known one. See, from CA3 come down, you hit up on a peak. Again, complete the square. And you see this peak. This one is a perfect square. That CA3, this CA3 is coupled to this one, that is CH2. And there is no other coupling possible, only one independent square. See, you cannot find any more coupling to either CH2 or CA3. No cross mix anywhere. Clear? That shows this formula coupled spin system. Then what is left next? Next, we consider this one. This could be this terminal CA3. Start with this, come down, and then complete a square. So A is coupled to 2. Fine. But at the same time, you see, A has two cross, one has two cross peaks. It also has a long range correlation to this proton. You understand? See, now, one is coupled to 2, also to 3. And 2 is also coupled to 3. And 1 and 3 are coupled. You understand the point now very clearly? 1 is coupled to 2. That square is completed. At the same time, you see cross peak between these two. Then what is left over? This is 3. So, this is a diagonal peak. There is a cross peak between this peak and this peak. So, this must be proton 3. Also, you can see there is a cross peak between 3 and 1. You can see the cross peak here, here and here. So, complete the square. Now, you see the cross peak between 3 and 1. So, 1 has a coupling to both 2 and 3. It formed one coupled spin system. Interestingly, we saw long range correlation in this Cauchy spectrum. And this is another Cauchy spectrum, another spin system where we got only correlation to two coupled partners. I hope you understood how we can interpret the Cauchy spectrum. Well, this is the last example I will take so that you become more familiar with the Cauchy. There is no point in continuing further like this. There are infinite number of molecules there. You can keep on interpreting, analyzing several till you become convergent. But I am giving you the idea, I am giving you the hint how to go ahead in analyzing the Cauchy spectrum. I think with this you can continue further. Now here, there are 7 groups of chemically inequivalent protons. It is a very famous molecule. You can see in most of the literature and in web, you can see this type of spectrum, this molecule. Everybody takes this as a fantastic example to analyze the Cauchy, Toxy, etc. Now, where do you start here? Remember, there are two CH3s here. They are coming here. Both could be attached to CH2 and CH2. They're, as a consequence, both are triplet. But I do not know which is which. But there is one clue for me. This CH3 is coupled to this CH2. And there is a break here because there is no C proton here. This should have a long range coupling. If that coupling is not seen, this forms one spin system and this forms one spin system. So you must get cross peaks between these two and cross peak among all these coupled partners. That is one hint for me from looking at the molecule. So Let me start like that. Start with the CH. Other way out is CH2 group closest to the ketonyl. That's correct. CH2 group closest. These two peaks should be shifted to the downfield because of CO. Either this or this. That's what we have to take. No problem. The CH2 group closest to ketonyl, ketone carbonyl, either this or this, both of them will come to downfield. And you can, I see it is written here, both are 2 and 4 written. Now, one of them you take, it will complete a square. No other coupling you can see here. Carefully, if you see, this will form a square. And this has to be 2 coupled to 1. It forms a set of coupled spins. 2 spins which are coupled, nothing else. No other coupling is possible. But if you go carefully, there is another one here. See, this is slightly different frequency. If you draw a line, this is like here. And this frequency is slightly above. This forms a line with this. Now, another that completed. Now, we'll start with next. If there is a confusion here, we start with the CA3 because this CA3 is identified. Now, we come to CA3 here. Easy, because we cannot make a mistake with CA3. Once you know this CA3, this has to be proton 7. Start with that. Come down and complete the square. What do you understand? Proton 7 has a coupling partner with 6. It has to be 6. Clear? So you formed a square. But this is not the end. Continue. This diagonal, from this if you come down, you see one peak here, go horizontal, go up and you see another peak here. Oh, there is a testing some error in this writing. Don't worry, this peak, these lines have shifted a bit, but this is cross peak. You can see now 6 is coupled to 5. It forms a cross peak. Now go down further. 5 is coupled to 4. That is also understood now. So very clearly, you could identify all the spins which are coupled in this group. All the spins sequentially, you can say and find out this is coupled to this, this is coupled to this, this is coupled to this. You identified all the peaks. And you identified this coupled spin system as a separate independent group. Everything is clear now. This is the way you can go ahead and analyze any Cauchy spectrum, however complex it is. Simply look at the diagonal peak. And then if you see, happen to see a cross peak, find out its diagonal, which is equidistant on either side, which is giving cross peak, and that must be the peak on the diagonal. These two are coupled. Like that, you can identify the coupled partners. So what I am going to do is, I will stop today. In next class, we continue further and more about other 2D experiments.